Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome here to Marshall Davery Hall for this afternoon's presentation by Charlene Bearhead. I'm Ann Sherman. I'm the Dean here in Education. And whenever we begin an event here, we like to acknowledge that we're on the traditional unceded territory of the Wolastoqiyik people. And as part of that recognition and acknowledgement, we're really pleased this afternoon to have our university elder, Imelda Purley, with us to do a little welcome ceremony and give us a few instructions and things to think about as we listen through this afternoon.
Wuliwinan. Ablasomas nokmas liwiagopen, okmikamiwan, nikadan, amanagunalog tajakuk liwiswuk, wuliwin sibedabasegid wulastakuk. Thank you for this opportunity to have a space for my language. And Wolastoqiyik territory is a beautiful and bountiful river that has sustained us for generations and hopefully continues to sustain. One of the things is my traditional name, Ablasomwes, which I'm proud to stand and still able to say, because there was a time in our histories that name was not allowed in the classroom. Ablasomwes, which means moon of the whirling wind. Okmigamiwin is grandmother rain, is one of my spirit names. And the other one is Mungunalog, rainbow cloud, which is a teaching that we share information with all peoples, not just one group of people. So that's what I'm standing here before you today. And to welcome our guest this morning, we did a sweetgrass ceremony as a reminder of seven generation thinking, so that she would know that in our territory we still acknowledge the medicines from our earth mother. And this morning we use sweetgrass, and the sweetgrass is a reminder of how when we're braided together in one braid, how strong we are. And that's what we try to encourage in conversations we're about to be involved in and to listen to. Midday, we do sage. And sage is just to, just in case there was some negativity or an emotion that was misunderstood or a feeling that came that wasn't there when you first came, the sage is what cleanses it so that we start the next part of the day without any negativity, without any burdens, without any, you know, interruptions. And so I'm just going to light this sage so that we can all be of one mind, you know, as our elders would say, and one braid. So I'm going to light that, and I'm just going to kind of send it to the four directions. And so when we do these smudges, it's so that we open our minds to new ways of thinking. We use our eyes to see things differently. We listen with two ears so that we hear other opinions and other worldviews. The medicine is used so that we remember how good smell is to us. Everybody has a favorite smell. You know, when the food was coming and everybody turned, dinner's here, you know. So we have that gift, but we kind of abuse those gifts sometimes and don't acknowledge. And that's why we use the different medicines. That's why smudging is so important, so that when we smell our Earth Mother's gift, it reminds us of who we are as Earth Walkers, that we're walking on this beautiful path together. We bring the smoke to our mouth so that we speak honorably of each other, and we praise more than we complain. We bring the smoke to our hearts so that we know our hearts are not just for human love. It's for love of all creation. We bring the smoke to our hands so that we know whatever documents we're going to write about or what our hands are going to be useful for, it'll leave beautiful teachings for generations yet to see our work. And of course, we bless our feet and we bless our purpose, why we're here today as listeners, as educators, as presenters, as the tech guys have very something important to do because they're leaving it behind. So everybody here has a beautiful purpose today, and that's what I'm honoring for each of you, Wuliwin. And I'll just do a quick smudge.
To the east for
illumination. Sauna snow kelyuk for our heart medicine. Kuskia snow kelyuk for our ancestral knowledge. All of us carry DNA from seven generations before. Lotkwa snow kelyuk for the north. So where all wisdom comes from.
Thank you, Imelda. I also want to welcome this afternoon people who are watching this via live streaming. We have people in our campuses in Bathurst, in St. John, and in Moncton, who we'd like to welcome to this afternoon's session. And really pleased that we're able to spread out beyond just the Fredericton campus. Charlene Bearhead is here. She's been traveling around the Maritimes. We think this is day 12 she's been on the road. She spent yesterday with District West teachers, morning, one group in the morning, one in the afternoon. And this morning she spent time with the Faculty of Education talking specifically about what we could do in education. But we've asked her this afternoon to talk about what she's been seeing across Canada at different universities as they think about ways that they can decolonize their registrar's practices, their human resources, their financial services, their academics, all of the different aspects that need to be considered when we think about how we welcome our Indigenous students. Charlene herself is a former teacher and superintendent in schools in Alberta. She was part of the group that led the Project for Heart, which the New Brunswick result is the beautiful wampum belt sculpture that's in our front foyer that honored the lives of survivors of residential schools, and she coordinated that project across Canada. There are 13 different art installations as a result of that, and so we're very proud to be the host of that installation here. I think you'll find her stories very powerful and thought-provoking, and I know you'll enjoy your time with her. So please join me in welcoming Charlene Bearhead. We will have time for some questions at the end.
Is that working? Does not sound, is it working? Yeah, good. Okay, sorry. Technology is not my strong point. Abwashdit, Opa Bin Shawir, Imigebi, Ishnish, Adewaka, Ishnish, Inamakuche, Ishnish, Wichashta, Willustaguk. So I would, and also thank you so much, Imelda, for the prayer and for the smudge to center us and to ground me before we get started. So Ishnish for that. I just would like to acknowledge, of course, I've acknowledged that we're in the territory of the Willistaguk, but also that I am a visitor here from Treaty 6 territory and want to express my gratitude to all of the Indigenous people whose territory I'm on and to all of you from the university for welcoming me and inviting me to share what little bit I know about this journey that we're on together and that we can share the little bits and pieces that we all know so that we can think about how we can advance this journey and continue this journey. And when Imelda talks about, you know, our the next generations and for the seven generations forward, one of the things that I have to ask myself all the time in this process, and one of the things that I invite educators, because most of my work is with educators in schools, in universities, when I think about what happens when I go out to work with teachers and not many non-Indigenous teachers who hear some of this for the first time, which is actually kind of shocking when you think about the fact that in this country, after 160 plus official years of residential school, within that much larger context of colonization, that we can say in the beginning of this work in 2007, when people started to become more educated. And that doesn't mean everyone. There were many people that were starting to do this work alone, in little pockets, long before that, and talked about how lonely that journey was, and how comforting it is and exciting it is to now have more and more people walking the path together. But many teachers early on who were learning this for the first time would ask partway through the day, do you think that my parents and my grandparents knew this was happening and they did nothing? There was nothing different? And I can't answer that question because I wasn't there. And as much as I would like to tell my children that I am the all-knowing, I am really not, and I have some very limited experience. But I think that what I can answer for myself, and it's certainly the question I ask myself, and I invite other people to ask themselves, is when my grandchildren and great-grandchildren are sitting in these rooms, and our grandchildren and great-grandchildren, indigenous or non-indigenous, are sitting in rooms discussing who we are with one another as indigenous and non-indigenous people, wherever we are in this country that has become generally known as Canada, will they be asking the question? We were at this place at a different time. We were at this place in this country in 1907. And obviously I mean that in a general sense because I'm old, but I'm not that old. I wasn't actually physically there. But we were at this place. There was a report. There was already a report. There was a report in 1907 when Peter Bryce, chief medical examiner for Indian Affairs, went out to visit schools. He visited 35 residential schools in the prairies. And he brought the answers back and he brought the evidence back. And he delivered that report that he called Canada's National Crime. He delivered it to Duncan Campbell Scott. I think we may all know, or many of us might know, what happened with that evidence. And it certainly wasn't widely and openly distributed. He was demoted in his position. And let's not ever underestimate the power of power, of position, of flexing muscle that may or may not have been earned. Let's remember that Peter Bryce was the chief medical inspector. He was a highly regarded physician. He wrote the first health codes for Ontario, which were then adopted across the country. Duncan Campbell Scott was a guy who started out as a clerk, whose father worked for Indian Affairs, who was able to suppress the truth, demote Peter Bryce, but he couldn't stop his spirit. Because when he finally retired in 1922, I believe was the year, Peter Bryce never stopped hounding the government about his findings. He never stopped pushing to advocate for what he knew was right. His soul wasn't for sale. He took the demotion. He moved on. But he never abandoned what he believed was his calling. Otherwise, why would he have pushed so hard? And his only calling was to be a decent human being, to do what was right, to not sacrifice children for position, for acknowledgement, for money. His ancestors were gathered with us at Beechwood Cemetery a year ago in August to honor Peter Bryce, to acknowledge what he had done. When Cindy Blackstock and Ed Bianchi from Kairos and Sylvia Smith, the founder of Project of Heart, and many other people were gathered, there were 23 descendants of Peter Bryce that were there. What was shocking to me, I guess maybe not surprising given the character that he embodied, none of his descendants knew what he had done. Even in 2015, none of his descendants knew the sacrifices that he'd made to try to push for better conditions for First Nation, Métis, and Inuit children in residential schools. As a result, there's a documentary being created by his great-grandson, who happens to teach media at Camosun College in Victoria. And because of the discovery from Cindy, simply looking, you know, if there was a phone book, that's where she would have looked. Looked up the family online and said, is it okay for us to honor your great-grandfather? His grandchildren and great-grandchildren now can say, he did something different, he tried. But for the most part, we know that 89 years and thousands of children's lives could have been different had we acknowledged the evidence, had we humbled ourselves, those people who are in powerful positions. Probably everybody's seen Spider-Man. With great power comes great responsibility. Sometimes people forget that part, and we get hung up on the power but forget the responsibility. So now we find ourselves in that place again, and there's more evidence, because this time thousands of survivors came forward and courageously shared their stories. And I can't speak for the survivors and say why they came forward, but I think it's pretty safe to say that I don't think survivors of residential school shared their stories publicly because that was a comfortable, positive, pleasant experience. I'm going to say that for the most part, what I've seen is survivors shared their stories, and that was a sacrifice that they made at the expense of their own comfort and at the expense of their own ability to sort of remain anonymous, because they believed more strongly that the Canadian public needed to know, that our children need to know the truth, that our teachers need to know the truth, that those people who are taking a look at how do we, I know we've got the Dean of Engineering here, and we take a look at how do we plan buildings and building sites. Because even that, when we take, we can learn from what happened in residential schools. We look at how space and how structure and how architecture was used as well to oppress children and to create a sense of fear, to keep people down and keep people back. And we think about the fact that residential schools were designed with no playgrounds for children, but were designed from the beginning with cemeteries. When we take a look at the design and the site plans for residential schools, in many cases, people would think, and it's easier for us to sort of comfort ourselves and think, they had to build cemeteries because children were dying at residential school. Children were dying of tuberculosis. Children were dying from other causes. And then you get to look at the site plans and you see that new residential schools were designed with cemeteries in the original design. I don't know, I've never seen one, there might be one, but I don't know that there was ever a school designed with a playground for children that were 5, for children that were 10. We know that Peter Bryce, in his report, Canada's National Crime, when he uncovered data and information that showed that on average, over a 16-year period, it wasn't because it was a bad year that he was sent out. When he examined the records and documents and looked at the sites, and records were from over approximately 16-year period, that on average, 24-25% of the children in the residential schools died there. And that at File Hill School in Saskatchewan, 75% of the children over a 16-year period died there. And the response from Duncan Campbell Scott was that we know Indian children are dying at a much higher rate in residential schools than they are in their home communities, but residential schools are a necessary component of our agenda of assimilation. Now, I've heard people say that quote's taken out of context. I don't know what context you could put that in that would make that be okay. I may be missing the boat, but I can't think of a context. within which that would be okay. If one child died in one of our schools, right now, all hell would break loose, as it should. And yet children were dying, and they were not just dying of tuberculosis. They were dying because of abuse. They were dying because they were, I'm not sure how many people saw the Heritage Minute that came out on June 21st about little Charlie Winjack. He died at the age of 12 because he froze to death running away because of the sexual abuse that he was suffering at the school that he was at. I think it was 1,200 miles or 1,200 kilometers, I don't remember. The point is, it was far. I don't know that at this, in this story, that it matters whether it was 1,200 miles or 1,200 kilometers, or whether there are 80,000 or 150,000 or how many years residential schools operated. I think what matters is that little Charlie died when he was 12, because he was trying to go that distance home in the winter and froze to death trying to wait for the train. And I think that it matters to people in families that there are still ground scanning activities going on where churches, religious orders, and other organizations are working together to still try to find where the children are buried. I think that matters. I think it matters to us if we think about our own children and grandchildren. You know, we talked about this yesterday when people say, well, you know, I don't think it was that bad. I think that always happens. That other kids in other parts of the world went to boarding schools, or this happened or that happened. Or I have children. I have a lot of children. Many, many, many children. And I think about, you know, leaving my kids for a few hours with my mother or with my sister. And any of us that are parents know that if they feel like they're going to be a little bit lonely at all, there's a crying that happens that breaks your heart, even though you know full well that they're with your family and they're fine and you'll be back in a few hours. I can't even begin to imagine what that would be like. And I don't think you need to be First Nation. I don't think you need to have experienced that to understand that it's wrong. And so when we have people who start to defend what's happening or what's happened, they were well-meaning people. They meant well. They were trying to help. Well, some of the most damning evidence against that particular theory is found in government documentation. I'm not sure if people here saw the interim report of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in 2012. They came for the children. I think it's on page 11 or 12. And I really know approximately where that is in that book, because I've had to look it up, especially early on, working with especially high school history and social studies teachers, people who feel like they were educated. And if people, we can't blame people that they think they're educated because they were more educated than anybody else around these issues. But I was called out by a teacher in high school in Alberta, and I think it was June of 2012. The report was released in February. When I talked about land acquisition as having been one of the driving factors for residential school. And this educated, experienced high school history teacher said, you better have some evidence to back that up, because I've never heard that. I said, well, actually, on page 12, I think it is, you will see a quote from a bureaucrat within the federal government that says, it's highly unlikely that a people whose children are under the complete control of a government will give that government trouble of a serious nature. That doesn't sound very well-meaning to me. That sounds pretty threatening to me. My loose translation of that is, if you hold people's children hostage the thing that's most precious to people, people are not going to fight over land or property or resources. And especially when you think about a people who don't value land and property and resources above human life and above any life. So you've got those sort of very conflicting worldviews happening. So those are all things that I believe from my perspective, and I am one person with one belief and one perspective. But I believe that it's important for us to understand that history, not so that we can sound like we're, you know, all the all-knowing and that we've got all this covered and we can beat somebody else in a debate over whether or not our views are accurate. I think it's important that we understand this history so that we can understand and acknowledge in a respectful way that it is. No matter how many different ways somebody writes something on a piece of paper and publishes a view, in the end, the truth is the truth, is the truth. And when you think about what people start to try to defend and debate and dig in, what are people defending? What do we have to defend? And what do we fear? What do we have to lose by acknowledging that, yes, in fact, that happened, that continues to happen in child welfare, that assimilation continues to happen? We just call it the curriculum or the program of studies now, and it applies to everyone. What do we have to lose by doing something completely differently? I think that we can all agree, and maybe not, but I'll tell you a message that I hear. It doesn't matter which province or territory I'm visiting, where we're working around education, people say, we are failing our children. And not just we are failing our First Nation children, we are just failing our First Nation children more than any other children. But a message I hear loud and clear is, we are failing our children, period. Why are we clinging to that then? What do we have to lose by looking at some change? And I think one of the biggest changes that I'm hoping for is our views of Indigenous education. For the most part, people hear Indigenous education or Aboriginal education, and people think education of Indigenous children or education of Aboriginal children. But every child in this country, every adult in this country, if you put your feet down in the morning when you get out of bed, you are putting your feet on someone's traditional territory. There was no such thing as a void space that someone dropped into from someplace else at the time of contact. And there were not structures, laws, there wasn't science, there weren't approaches to health, there wasn't a justice system. There is no place that you can put your feet down where people didn't either live or travel or gather or camp or trade in this country. So if we think about the thousands of years that those systems endured, served people well, kept the environment intact. And that doesn't mean that everybody was getting along and the tribes all loved one another and everything was just perfect, because darn it, they were human beings. That H factor always gets in the way. But the reality is that when you think about those thousands of years, and then we look at the last 150, we have certainly revved up the destruction phase of things in a short period of time. So I bring up many of those issues that I believe that we can take a look at, because it's not just about learning about residential schools in social studies, passing a test, getting a good grade on a course, and saying, okay, I understand now. I understand because I've heard. It's about who are we with one another? How do we respect one another, or how do we not respect one another? And just speaking to that isn't enough. But the residential school era, which was a lot longer than we think, and a lot more recent than we think, I believe is really kind of the gateway to understanding all that's connected. Because it was through the residential schools where there was the most profound interference with that knowledge. So not only were First Nation, and in some areas Inuit, and in some places Métis children, put in residential schools and taught that their knowledge was not valid, that the wisdom of their elders and their parents and the community members and the knowledge keepers was, never mind not valid, but actually of the devil. I talked about this morning. One of the pieces that I really think about from the film We Were Children is when the little girl Lina talks about how she just hoped that she could end up going to hell. Because what she was told over and over again was that if she didn't convert to Christianity, she was going to go to hell, and all of her people were going to go to hell because they weren't Christian. And she just thought, I hope I get to go to hell because that's where all my people will be, and that's where I'll be loved and comforted and looked after and valued. Children get it. They don't have those sort of artificial imposed understandings of what that might be, whether it's university, school, or hell. Because that's what it translates to be sometimes if you don't see yourself there, if you don't feel valued there, if there's nothing about that place and that space and the rules that apply to you that have anything to do with who you are. So I just thought we might talk about that a little bit as far as kind of putting some context to what is indigenizing the academy. What does that mean? Because that is something that I would guess, I'm not sure, I haven't been to every university in the country, but I would say that if not every post-secondary institution in the country, 99.6 something percent would be looking at that right now, because people don't sit in their offices, in their homes. I don't think that people sit there and think, how am I going to beat this and maintain control of the world and never do anything good because I don't want to. I truly do not believe people do that at a conscious level. I think that most people are good, whatever good is. I really believe that most people want to do good. They want to do good things, especially as they have the information. But I think that sometimes people, A, don't know how, and B, have been so educated about what that is, what good looks like, what success looks like, what achievement looks like, that we are very disconnected with, or really it's difficult for us to see other people's perspectives. So I always say that I think the majority of people are good, and often people think that negativity or negative people are the majority. They're just louder than everybody else. That's really all it ever is. But it's usually a very small group. And I was really excited when Anne said to me that we have people from, you know, facilities, and we have people from finance, and we have people from all different faculties, because in the end, just because Call to Action 62 calls upon, you know, federal, provincial governments to create curriculum around residential schools and First Nation, Métis, and Inuit culture and history, the first place people go is the Faculty of Education. Okay, the Faculty of Education can take care of this because the Faculty of Education teaches teachers, and teachers are going to teach kids. Except eventually the kids are then going to go on to post-secondary and the kids are going to go to different faculties. And the people in faculties now are going to go out and they're going to be the healthcare providers in hospitals, in places like the hospital in Winnipeg where Brian Sinclair died as he sat in the waiting room. And I believe he was dead for several hours before anybody noticed he was dead. Because, oh, he was just an Indian that was drunk. That is tragic. That is disrespectful beyond disrespectful. That is something that happened right here in this country. I heard something last week about an individual that went into a hospital and sat there and waited and waited, and it was his granddaughter, I think, that talked about pleading with the doctors and the nurses to do something. And they said, oh, he's just drunk again. And they ended up finally, and it was because I was in the community, I just realized it was because I was in the community, and they were talking about the loss of an elder. And they finally medevaced him, and it was in BC, and by the time, he was having a stroke. And by the time he got there, his condition had deteriorated so badly that he didn't actually ever come out of the coma, and he died a couple of days later. I was invited to work with some judges in Ontario a few weeks ago. And I think that when we're in a room with a group of judges and judges are crying, I have hope. That gives me hope. Because when people who hold the future of other people in their hands care enough that they can really look at what's happening. And sometimes that's heartbreaking. But it also means that now their hearts are open, and if their hearts are open, then their minds can be open, and they can start to look at what is actually happening. What is really the best thing that we can do with, not for, but with this person and for the community? What do we do to help lift people up and support people and walk with people as opposed to labeling them, putting them off to the side, out of sight, out of mind, and losing all the potential that that person also carries? So let's talk about how do we indigenize. It's been really interesting, and I just need to tell you up front, I don't have the answer. So I don't know what that is, but I think the people of the territory have the answers. I think that some of you have parts of the answer. And I think that if we come together, and that very core teaching that's common to most indigenous groups is humility. If we can just humble ourselves and get over our egos and our need to be, and sometimes I think that need to be important isn't even really a need to be important. It comes from that societal need to be accepted or viewed by others as valid or knowing. But I think if we can humble ourselves and just look at what are we good at? What is my part? What is my part maybe in this indigenization? What is my part in reconciliation? What is my part in carrying out the 94 calls to action? I ask people, don't read through the calls to action, please, and look and say, it doesn't say here anywhere, Martha, we call upon you. I'm like, okay, I'm out. I'm okay, they didn't ask me. I think we all need to read through and think about that, because only we know ourselves. We know ourselves better than anyone else. We know what we can contribute. And we'll know what we can contribute to that process in our universities as well. And it will probably take every single person's little contribution, because it's not going to be a new paint job on the walls. It's not going to be changing out some pictures. It's not going to be acknowledging the territory at graduation and then forgetting about that for the rest of the year. It's going to be about each of us being able to open our minds and open our hearts and see each other and hear each other without, and it'll get further and further for all of us. It gets a little bit longer each time before something in us goes, oh, no, that's as far as I can go with that. And it'll, you know, because we're human. And we need to understand that it'll take us time and we'll move a little bit further each time. So I shared this morning, which I share all the time, and so I just keep hoping at some point, I think we got somewhere today. I can't stand the word indigenize. It drives me crazy. Because it sounds like you're doing something, that you are, if we're indigenizing it, it sounds like we're bringing a process to something that is already existing. So this, whatever it is that we're indigenizing, is something that is pre-existing, and we're going to do this process, and that's going to change it. But really, I think that's backwards. Because this thing that we say we're going to indigenize is not the pre-existing thing. The university, those structures, those rules, those ways of thinking are not the pre-existing thing. What's pre-existing is what other people are looking to infuse. It's the context. What's pre-existing is what comes from the land that it was built on top of. What's pre-existing is the spirit of the people that are connected to that land. And what's pre-existing within that are the natural laws of that land. And so maybe, I don't know, and I said I don't know the answer, so I don't know what the word is either. But maybe it's as we can sort of take those things away and push them back a little bit that have been built, whether it's the structures. So maybe it means that we do more about learning that's connected to the land. And we think about what was here and what's under here and what still exists around us here. So I did say this morning that I think, as close as I can come up with, is that the reason that we struggle with that is because indigenize is an English word. And it has already, when we think about it, there's already this preconceived notion of what that means. Eleanor Bernard said in a meeting that we were at St. Effects on Wednesday, as Anne said, it's day 12. Sorry, I'm getting a little warm here. This room was really warm yesterday, too. On day 12, it's not day 12 here, it's only day 8 in the Maritimes, I think, because I was in BC before that and then came straight over. But Eleanor talked about that, and I was so relieved because now she wouldn't call herself an elder. I'm going to say to me she's an elder. And so to me, whenever I hear an elder say something that I'm saying, I'm like, yes, maybe I'm right on that one. I think I'm closer, you know, maybe I know a little bit. Or I've learned, I think would be more accurate to say a little bit. And she said, I hate the word indigenize. This is before I even started talking. I'm like, okay, I'm on the right track. But this was her reason. She said, I hate the word indigenize. Because it puts us all in one boat, it sounds like, across the country. So again, for convenience, we use the word indigenized because then everybody at every university can say indigenized because it's in English, it's something that everybody can get, so we can call it that. Because God help us, we wouldn't want to inconvenience ourselves and have to learn a different word in each territory. So she said, we're going to Mi'kmaq guys over. And she, you know, she laughed and it was a bit light, but at least that was closer, you know. And I was really happy because 2 days before that, we were in Charlottetown. And we had representatives from the Ministries of Education in New Brunswick, Nova Scotia, and PEI. And we were working on, and also Carolyn Sark was there from Abigwit in Prince Edward Island. And we were looking at a framework for early years, grade 1, 2, and 3, around residential school education and, you know, Mi'kmaq in that particular territory, Mi'kmaq, and the reps from New Brunswick are looking at grade 3 as the piece that they took for Mi'kmaq and Maliseet. And we got to a place that I thought was really exciting, because sometimes I hope we're going to get to this place someday. When we were in that process in Charlottetown, we talked about Mi'kmaq ways of knowing, and Mi'kmaq science and art and music and storytelling and communication and language. And so this was going really well because somebody said something about First Nation. And then we started to talk about that, but there's not such a thing. That's not a culture, it's a group. And I say, respectfully, that would, to me, I always think of it as like, that's like saying you're white. What is that? Are you French? Are you German? Are you Polish? What? That is not a culture. First Nation is a group, but there is no one, there's no tribe that's First Nation. There's no nation that's First Nation. So this was the first time I've seen somebody put this into an actual different worldview. So one of the things we said is, well, what would that look like from a Cree worldview? And I love that because that's where we need to get. Every nation is a different nation with their own language, with their own perspectives, with their own views. So we started to then move that along to, okay, so maybe that's what it is. And I'm going to ask Imelda if she will say this because I can't, because I have to practice. But this morning we talked about this and we said, what would that be? And Imelda, do you mind explaining what we, which means Imelda, came up with this morning?
I've been practicing. Yeah.
Oh, good girl, Anne.
Well, the word that we were thinking about was reconciliation, and which would be the same thing as indigenization, as opposed to making everybody think in Maliseet or think in Mi'kmaq or think in that way. The word is, how it starts is you have to change your mind, like just kind of rethink. And then once your mind, you know, you look at things differently, but you also have to walk that talk. So the word is Bilui Dahazawausawagan. Bilui Dahaz is that I've been thinking this way all this time, but I'm gonna add a new perspective that I admire and respect that is going to be universal. Wausawagan is I'm also gonna walk the talk of that thinking so that my earth walk will be affected by this new thinking that I'm going to share universally.
Shneesh, thank you. Do you want to give it to them? Shneesh, thank you. So, isn't that beautiful? And what I love about when we have terms in the language is within that, it's not just a label. There's instruction for us about what that path looks like. There's instruction about how we can get started in that. So there's things around language, there's things about us considering that and really changing that path. But there's so much to look at. When we think about place, when we think about structures, when we think about how we engage, when we think about expectations or how we define success, I guess. And I was sharing again this morning when we talked a little bit about Commissioner Marie Wilson. We were having a discussion and she spoke about this and I really liked what she said. And she said, you know, oftentimes, and this was at the University of Manitoba, and she said, oftentimes in universities, life is very competitive. It's very, you know, students are competing for funding. Students are competing for marks so that they can move on to the next level. So she said, in some ways, when we look at things, being a leader means being first, being best. Or being first sometimes means being above everybody else or being at the top of your class, whatever that is. But there are very narrowly defined measures for what makes you first. She said, sometimes being first just means somebody who has to go first. Someone has to be the first one to do something or try something. And that isn't always a place that people want to be. People, it's easier to think about being first as being best, but sometimes it's a little bit unnerving to think about being first, especially when you're going to take on something that's been that way for a very long time. And the people who are the keepers of that want to keep it that way. And not because they're terrible people, but because they can't imagine how that might work if it's different. I think of a friend of mine, Patrick Lawyer, that is a First Nation man that works for the Alberta Teachers Association. And one day we were getting ready for a big gathering of educators, and it was going to be superintendents and teachers and school board trustees and people from faculties of education and First Nation people and Métis people in the Edmonton area. And we needed to put in paperwork for Patrick to get tobacco to do an offering. And he said, oh, I dread it when I have to put in the paperwork, because every time I have to explain to the finance people why we're spending ATA money on tobacco. Now, this was a few years ago. You would be amazed at how progressive that whole organization is now in this movement around residential school, First Nation, Métis, and Inuit education. And he said, oh, it's so frustrating. And I said, you know what, it never occurred to me, but thank God you have to go and put in the paperwork to ask for the money for the tobacco, because then the people in finance get the opportunity to also be educated. Because why is that fair that if you work in plant management or you work in finance or you work in, you know, in the business management office, that you're not getting the education that other people are getting in this period of time where things are really shifting? It doesn't matter what job you do, you are still a member of the community that has not had the benefit, for the most part, of understanding and learning about the first peoples and practices and teachings in the territory. So I was very happy and excited when Anne talked about all the different people that would be here, whether you're in law, whether you're in nursing, whether you're in business. I mean, think about business owners and think about how many First Nation people talk about. You talked about that this morning, Imelda, even in a school where someone didn't want you close to his desk because he was afraid your First Nation children would steal things out of the desk. Think about how many business people that don't know. And it's not okay, but if they don't know, they don't know. It doesn't matter if it's okay or not okay. We need to educate people. So there you go. I have zero answers for you about indigenizing, but I think that if we start thinking about things other than content, but about just how we conduct ourselves, how we acknowledge, how we seek wisdom and knowledge, instead of thinking that we are the place for people to go for wisdom and knowledge, and how we can share that. So we talked about then also having some dialogue and discussion and questions and answers. Are there any? Is there anything else you want me to talk about before we do that, Anne?
No,
are we okay with that?
Questions, if you'd like. George is going to look after that part because he's got better legs than I do. I don't know if they're better legs.
I don't know if they're nicer,
yeah,
but
they're not as nice.
But they're more workable.
But I'll do the Phil Donahue thing and
yeah,
run around. So I'm George McLean. I'm the Vice President Academic, and I'll have a few words when we're done, but we want to make sure that there's time here for everyone to have some questions or comments. So we'll start with Nicole.
Thanks. Hi. I started law school about 20 years ago in Treaty 6 territory, but I didn't know it was Treaty 6 territory because no one had told me. I'd lived my whole life in Saskatchewan. I had no clue.
Yeah.
And one day, Sakej Henderson came in to teach our property law class. And after class, I said, I have a degree in Canadian history. I'm now through my law degree partway, and I had no idea what you were talking about this morning. What should I do? Should I go read some books or whatever? And he says, you're going to have to go find the answers yourself. And that's the kind of person he is, right? So here I am about 20 years later. I've done a master's and a PhD on Aboriginal law and Aboriginal issues or whatever. I know maybe less than when I asked him that day. And as we work on the TRC and how to implement, to get kind of practical here, just for a second, because I agree with you that there aren't any clear answers. This is not a paint job, okay? But what I have found at the various workshops I've been to, and I've given some of them, is that the conversation starts to circle around, well, do we put all students through a mandatory intro class? Sorry, I'm bringing up the chestnut.
No,
here.
It's okay. Good. I'm glad you brought this up because we have to talk about this.
Do we put everybody through? Or, like, I teach at the law school here, and I teach an elective upper year seminar, 18 students. You only take it if you want to. So I generally get people who are open-minded and are interested. But most of the people we're putting through our law school have never heard of any of the things that we're talking about in my class. And so now we have number 27 and 28 in the TRC saying we shouldn't have lawyers out in the world that lack the cultural competencies or the knowledge of the treaties or the UN Declaration or any of that. But my question for you is, if we do get the resources from the vice president academic who's standing right here and just handed me the mic to go to a mandatory framework, how do I deal with the people in that class? And I teach, all of the other classes I teach at the law school are mandatory, so I know what it's like to have people that don't really want to be there. How do you navigate that mandatory, where I agree with you, that we should all know, all the business owners, everybody should know, and they don't know, okay? How do we navigate that particular dynamic? That's my preoccupation.
Okay, this is probably a really strange, I don't know why I see things the way I do, but you know what it makes me think of is, you know, divorced parents? I mean, I was one, so. But my kids, I was lucky. My kids didn't have anybody else to go to, so they were stuck with me. It makes me sort of think of that. If people have someone else to play it off against or someplace else, you know, where they can sort of get through and get their way and not have to do what we know is the right thing to do, some people will do that. So I think we just have to ask ourselves, and here's the terrible thing about with great power comes great responsibility, or with great responsibility comes more responsibility when you're in those roles. Who's going to make the decision to go first? Who is going to just say, because in the end, somebody has to make decisions all the time, no matter what they're around. Somebody has the curse of being the person responsible for making the decisions. So I guess somebody has to make the decision about, I really worry about mandatory courses. I know that's a big thing right now, and I'm totally all about mandatory content and approaches. But when you have a mandatory course, and many universities have started this way, and people are really excited when a university has, now there's a mandatory course for every student to get their degree. And I'm not disrespecting that. I think every little step that we can take is a good one. But I worry about that because it still implies that it's a topic and it's in isolation and it's separate. And when you do that, you can put that aside now because you've done that and you've got that, you know, requirement out of the way, and now you can do your real work. I really think whether it's in grade one or in junior high or in law or in medicine, I think that if there's not the infusion of, and not the salt and pepper, sprinkle some nice stuff on top infusion, but embedded, real, parallel curricula. So looking at indigenous approaches to law, Western approaches to law. What does that look like? How can those complement one another? How do you start the day? How do you educate your lawyers so that they know whose territory they're practicing in? How do they know the people? I think that as long as we keep courses as a separate course, we are missing the point. I think that can be a step along the way. But I think that if there's no place else to go, because every course that you take, there is going to be an indigenous context, and there is going to be infusion and genuine, authentic, respectful infusion of the indigenous peoples of that land and that territory and their knowledge and their wisdom and their values and their beliefs and their approaches, then you don't have to fight about whether you have to take that course or that course, and you don't have to push back against it because every place you turn, there it is. And those pieces will all connect together. That probably didn't help you a bit, did it? Did it? Because then, you know, part two of the question is, I know that would help his perspective, but part two is, how do we make that happen? And sometimes it comes down to this. Somebody makes a decision, and it happens. That's what happened in the Northwest Territories and Nunavut with the curriculum change there. Jackson Lafferty was getting ready to go out and greet the people for the national event and decided as the premier and as the education minister to make the announcement. And the really great thing about when somebody who has that sort of responsibility and authority makes an announcement, everybody that works for them has to figure out how to make it happen. And I love it when people do those things because I'm like, gotta do it now. And we have to remember too that everything passes. And that doesn't mean we'll do it and then it goes away, but people will freak out. People will have temper tantrums. People will tell you all the reasons why this is ridiculous. And then they will complain about something else next week. If you're doing the right thing for the right reasons, you will continue to move forward, I believe.
Elizabeth?
Yeah. Last winter, I was at a seminar with Jim Miller from Saskatchewan.
Awesome.
And Jim emphasized that the phrase, we are all treaty people, mm-hmm. That the treaties that shape this country are not just treaties of indigenous peoples, yeah. That the peace and friendship treaties that shape this region are the treaties that all of us live with. It's treaties on both sides. You can't have one party to a treaty. And I've thought a long time about what that means. What is my responsibility as a Euro-Canadian or a Euro-North American for what it means to be a treaty person, what the responsibility is. And I think that from the non-Indigenous side, that's a useful place to begin because it puts the responsibility back on thinking about how I need to change to be a reasonable member of a treaty pact.
Yeah. Thank you. We had a long discussion about that this morning because that thinking around we're all treaty people has huge applications to us looking at reconciliation, right? Because what is that? It's building relationships. Treaties are relationships. And I won't talk a lot about that right now because I know we want to, you know, give people opportunities, but I do want to share one of the things that I shared this morning and that we talked about is, you know, for some people, that is a really foreign concept or it's a really new way of thinking, right? About, I'm a treaty person, I have treaty rights. So what I sometimes invite or challenge people to think about is how well intact must your treaty rights be as a non-Indigenous person that you don't even actually have to think about it? You don't even think about that or realize that. You know, I gave some examples this morning when we talk about, you know, the treaty right to health, to health care. And there's this constant delisting of medications and delisting of services, and you have to pay extra for this, and you have to pay extra for that if you're a First Nation person. I've never heard the delisting of or the deterioration of the treaty rights of a non-Indigenous person. Nobody says, actually, you know, that land that you live on, that you call yours now because you had access to that because people were pushed off their own land. Well, we've decided that we're only going to honor 80% of that, so you might want to move the fence in your backyard because that's actually not yours anymore. I mean, nobody would. So I just want us to think about that, and I appreciate you bringing that up as we think about, we all have rights, treaty rights in this country. And when you think about the peace and friendship treaties, it's even more logical, even in the actual name of the treaties. Although it's important to like yourself, it's pretty hard to have a friendship treaty with yourself. There has to be two sides to a treaty, right? Or to any relationship. So if we're talking about friendship, yeah, we have lots to uphold on that side of things too. So thank you for bringing that up today.
Thank you for coming here. And the province has recently released a report on education, a 10-year plan is there any new path in that plan that spells out a new way of doing things? I couldn't get beyond the platitudes of the plan and the PR of it, but do you have any knowledge of this plan, and is there a vision in it that speaks to your interests, all of our interests?
Thank you. I have to be completely honest with you that I haven't seen the plan yet. I knew that the plan was in the works, and I know this morning when CBC called in the opening, I didn't realize it was released yesterday because I was here all day yesterday, so, and then we had meetings all night last night, so I didn't actually see any news or anything. But this morning when they did the little thing that they do before they start asking questions, I said, oh, look at that, it was released yesterday. So I'm sorry, I don't know yet. You're making me a little nervous now when I think about it, when I'm going to read it, because, I'll tell you something else. Too many things that I think about or say, but when I think about the most dangerous weapon, I've said this for a long time, I think the most dangerous weapon that Europeans brought wasn't guns or alcohol or weapons, it was paper. Because as soon as something's on paper, for some reason, we think that it is. And just because something's on paper doesn't mean it is. But unfortunately, people see it on paper. So the apology, the federal government apology to residential school survivors, a prime example. You know, I think one of the first things our parents teach us when we're 3 or 4 is don't say you're sorry if you don't mean it. You're not supposed to say you're sorry just to get yourself off the hook. If you're sorry, you're supposed to actually do something different. And there's these lovely pieces of parchment paper hanging all over the country with the apology that was delivered by the individual that was the prime minister at the time. And I'm not going to say his name because I don't have to anymore because it's over. But that, you know, in the release of the interim report, the calls to action, actually they were recommendations at the time, and I was really happy that the commissioners called them calls to action because recommendations are optional. But there was a recommendation that all schools, well, I think it's at all secondary, but I say all schools to get everybody rolling along, post the apology in a prominent place in the school. And I think that's important, but not so that we can say, see what Canada did? Aren't we awesome? I think it's a reminder to say, remember what, you know, who said on the 11th of June in 2008? These are all the things we still have to be working towards. So I haven't read the plan yet. I am going to tell myself right now that it's amazing and it's going to be awesome and that it's really real and people are going to do great things with it. And then I'm going to read it and I'm going to hope that I was right. But it's like anything else. You know, you have the best policy in the world, and if nobody implements it, it doesn't really matter, right? It's like curriculum, mandatory curriculum, that, you know, Alberta made that commitment, and Alberta was this close to rolling that out, and then realized, wait, if we don't educate all the teachers and give them the support and the resources and the knowledge that they need, that is going to go right beside our cap on the shelf to collect more dust. And we can't let that happen. Alan?
Alan. We've got a bit of a list.
George gets to decide.
Sorry,
Alan.
I'll get to you right away, Alan. Jennifer, you were next.
I actually have a pretty specific question. I hope I'm not throwing a loop for you.
Okay.
And thank you for coming. This has been an incredible pleasure. I teach Canadian Lit, and I teach a lot of Indigenous Lit. I've worked on Indigenous literature for most of my career. And I do a lot of incorporation of Indigenous literature into all of my classes. And I'm just curious about how you feel about, and this is something probably kind of technical, but I'm interested in what you might recommend or think about. Is it more helpful to be teaching material from local? I mean, we've talked a little bit about this, but I tend to teach a variety of stuff from across the country, various tribes. How helpful is it to be teaching local tribal community stuff over other materials, other Indigenous materials, and other materials, period. Mm. I'm just curious about that. And that's something that's kind of a, I know it's a bit nuanced, but I think it's really, I'm curious as to what you might say. I'll just tell you too, I did teach Lauren Simon's novel a while ago, who's from the local community, and I had a huge fight with a student, a grad student, who actually told me that he didn't know how to write. And I ended up sitting with the student and saying, what's really going on here? And it turned out the student was jealous of how well Simon had learned to write at such a young age, that his career wasn't as far advanced as Lauren Simon, and therefore had decided that was his way to attack the book. So I think those kinds of difficult discussions are great. But yeah, if you have any thoughts on that, I'd be really grateful.
Okay, and you know, you all know more about this than I do, but I'll tell you what I think and the way I look at it. Again, to me it comes around to the context. And when we were having our discussions about the early years work and the curriculum development, and there's work that's being done on treaty education in Nova Scotia right now, and they were talking about infusing throughout the program of studies in this treaty education program, Mi'kmaq in their case, music and games and so on. And what I suggested was, I think that maybe in whatever it is that we're doing, if we teach the Mi'kmaq, or in this case the Maliseet, the Wolastoq perspectives and stories and literature in your case first, because I think then it gives a sense, just because of the order that we're doing things in, that okay, so this is what's foundational, this is what was first, and then we start to then layer other work on top of that, and just by the order that we're doing that, we get a sense of what is where, what the context is. But the other thing that I want to say about what I, so I think it's really important to start with that teaching. But what I really like about when you're talking about teaching from other nations is I think it gives us that opportunity to do what I talked about earlier, as far as looking at, it doesn't have to be that it's a Japanese writer or a German writer or you know, a writer from Korea, an author from Korea, but that we can look at literature from a Cree writer, or from a Dene writer, or from an Abenaki writer, and realize that's another nation, so that is another worldview. And I am really excited that we're actually starting to get to that place, because not very long ago, it was hard to get people to even consider First Nation or Indigenous in that broader sense. So that's my thought. And I think it really is important, because I think that no matter, you know, we want people to look at other worldviews. Does that help?
Alan.
I just wanted to comment on Will's question. I haven't read the 10-year plan, but I can tell you that the discussion paper that began the process did not contain the term Aboriginal, First Nations, or Indigenous. There was no discussion in the discussion paper that began the process of setting out the 10-year plan. They did get some response on that. I know some people responded, and I think the plan does mention that, but it's not enough. Right now, the social studies curriculum in New Brunswick has some pretty sophisticated outcomes with regard to understanding Indigenous peoples in this territory, and in the wider Atlantic Canadian region in particular. And I conduct research on how teachers and students understand ethnic diversity, and I can tell you recent research in New Brunswick says they don't. And I'm not going to blame folks. I think what we've given, and largely in schools, is an unfunded mandate. We've set high standards, and we provide almost no background education for the teachers. We provide almost no in-service for the teachers. The materials we provide are insipid or just wrong. And we give the social education a very low priority in the curriculum. And I can tell you this, that a new 10-year plan, all the stuff leading up to it has said the same things, that we should focus on the STEM subjects, some physical education and the arts. It said very little about social education and the humanities generally. Mm-hmm. And if we want people to understand each other, we have to give that area curriculum focus, we have to prepare teachers to teach it, and we have to give them good materials. I was very happy to hear this morning that the National Center is developing a very good education page that's going to help teachers get at that. But it's not enough to say you're going to do it. We've been saying we've been going to do it for a year, but I'll just give you one example from our research. Almost none of the grade 7 children that we interviewed in New Brunswick recognized the terms Aboriginal, First Nations, or Maliseet. We were using that term because that was the general term at the time, even though the schools we worked in were literally steps from Maliseet communities. And when the kids did have knowledge, some of them did, when they did have knowledge, we would try to explore to them in interviews where that knowledge came from. They almost always referred to personal experience. Mm-hmm. My mother took me to a powwow. My grandfather is a First Nations person, or they had some personal connection. It was almost never school knowledge. And again, I'm not blaming teachers, because we've largely given teachers an unfunded mandate. We've asked them to do something. Mm-hmm. We have neither prepared them to do well, nor funded well in terms of providing them with resources.
And has a quick.
Okay, and then I am going to.
Yeah, I'm going to just add one thing, because I have read the plan. And for the first time in the history of New Brunswick, one of the 9 objectives is around First Nations students. Early years was also mentioned for the first time, and social and citizenship education was mentioned for the first time. And they talked a lot about, they know they have to put money into PD for teachers. And so it's my hope, it's now up to the rest of us to take this and do something with it. And it's my hope that if we can change the K-12 system, that then kids mm-hmm. who come to the university will start to have some of this knowledge as well about all those things. But it's very dependent on resources, as Alan yeah. said, and how we take those 9 objectives and actually put them into action.
Mm. I just want to invite you to take a look at the Northwest Territories has in their education system, they've just developed and they've just adopted it, the 5 competencies, and I love what they call it, the 5 competencies to be a capable Northwest Territories person. A Northwest Territories capable person. And I love that. And when you take, like, talks about nurturing yourself and who you're meant to be, it talks about negotiating change and challenges. So if you want to look into that, I would really invite you to look at that. To me, that's very hopeful when we actually value the human beings, whatever level they're at. And when you talk about the unfunded and unresourced, in Alberta, when I talked about maybe even this time last year, I would have never believed this, and it's amazing to be living in this time right now in Alberta. On June 22nd, the Ministry of Education, the Alberta Teachers Association, the school superintendents, the deans of education, the school board association, the school councils association, and the Council of Independent Schools and Colleges, and the National Center announced a joint commitment to action. And it's a 3-year plan. But what I love about 3-year plan, there's no paper that says this is the plan. The commitment was by the ministry, we will fund the Alberta Regional Professional Learning Consortia, we will fund all of these groups to work with the First Nations, Métis and Inuit people in the territory to come up with the plan, to implement the plan, and there will be the education of all 42,000 teachers that are in the field right now that didn't have the benefit of this education. All the teachers, the teacher candidates in the faculties of education, but also the school board trustees, the superintendents, and the parent councils. So there is hope. All I'm going to say to you is, I can tell you from being from Alberta, I would have never, ever believed that. And it's unbelievable. And in a shorter period of time, which goes back to the question about how does that happen, it's all about the will. That's all it comes down to is there the will by the people? I just said this morning that one of our elders, when we talked about what's the reason behind it, he said it's the golden rule. He who has the gold makes the rule.
Eula.
Thank you. I really appreciated that you talked about the importance of looking at sort of structure and that. But I do want to take you back a little bit towards content, if I may.
Mm-hmm.
One of the concerns that arise with the calls to action is that they have an implicit sort of narrative about what it is that students need to know or that we all need to learn. And in some ways, that narrative feeds into a pre-existing narrative of lack and deficiency and things being wrong. And I wonder to what extent a component of developing curriculum, a component of developing content, doesn't also have to be like a turning away from that and really a dedication to contribution, good life, values, rather than the narrative of deprivation, of abuse, and so on.
Well, I would say, first of all, I think that one thing that is, I see that's quite different in that narrative within the calls to action is, I think it draws our attention, if we look for it, is that the deficit is within the mainstream education system and population, as opposed to the usual focus on what is perceived as a deficit position of the indigenous people. I absolutely agree that we need to be looking at, and I've talked about this, indigenous knowledge as valid knowledge, you know, perspective, strengths, resilience, understandings, all of that. I think that there's sort of a critical path in that learning all the way through, that if we skip over, and some people want to just skip over the actual history because it's too painful, and I know that's not what you're saying, but I want to talk about that here, because sometimes we hear that and people say, well, okay, that's past, it's over, why do we have to talk about that? And I know, I don't think there's anybody here who had to hear the story yesterday already, but I liken it to if I went into the doctor's office and said, I need you to write me a prescription, I need to get better. And the doctor says, well, okay, but we need to look into this first and see what it is that's wrong with you and where this might have come from and what's actually happening before I write a prescription. And I'd say, well, no, it doesn't matter, just write something that'll heal me, let's just move on. That doesn't make any sense. So how do we move forward if we don't know what we're moving forward from? How do we avoid falling into the same holes? One of the faculty members that was with us this morning talked about this, that, you know, people are saying this can never happen again. And Cindy Blockstock will tell you, and we all know, it doesn't have to happen again. It's still happening. And in fact, we didn't get to talk about this morning as next steps because we ran out of time, but I don't even remember if it was Alan. Somebody said, not that I wasn't listening closely when you were speaking, Alan, but somebody said it seems like prisons are the next step to residential schools, but we're missing a step in between there. Really, child welfare is the new residential school, and prisons are where you graduate to in many, many cases when you come out of the child welfare system. And not always, but I wrote Glad You Pre-Sentence Reports, and I don't know, some of you will know what that is, but I don't know if everybody knows what that is, but Glad You Pre-Sentence Reports are reports that are supposed to be available to every Indigenous person who has been convicted of an offense and is to be sentenced. I'm not a lawyer, I don't have background in law, but I was asked to write some of the reports in what was considered to be more sensitive, or sometimes they called it high profile, which really wasn't, cases in Alberta because of when you look at the Glad You principles, time spent in foster care, intergenerational impacts of residential school, exposure to violence. And I will tell you that absolutely the most significant factor that I saw for people who were going to be incarcerated and because of events in their lives were people who were in placement after placement after placement after placement in the child welfare system. And the government will pay non-Indigenous or just people who are not related significant amounts of money that is tax-free, by the way, because it's not an income, it's maintenance for a child. But if you're a family member who is going to take the child to keep the child connected to the community or the family, there's little or zero money that somehow magically it doesn't cost you money to feed or look after a child if you are related to the child. So I think that, I mean, this is all, it sounds like it's all, but it's really all connected, I think. So I think that if we look at the strengths and the resilience and that knowledge, not only in the content of teaching children in schools and teaching social studies, but as we're teaching social workers, as we're teaching physicians, as we're learning, as police officers are being educated, for heaven's sakes, police officers, people who work in corrections. My husband was an elder in Edmonton Maximum Security Penitentiary for a period of time. And he talked about how, thankfully, he's just the most patient person. He's not me, let's just put it that way. And he would talk about, you know, how you have to, you're put into one secure area, moving from one part of the prison to another, and then the gates close there, and then you move along. And he said, you know, other people would get moved through very quickly, and there were people that were guards that would even keep the elders in there for a long time and, oops, not let them through. And then, oh, look at that, not let them through again. Or the abuse, the emotional abuse of some of the, they're not inmates, they're people who are incarcerated. So I think the content does need to come from a strength base, but I think it's that path of this is what's wrong, this is what's happened, this is the impacts, and then how do we take those strengths that you're talking about and move in a good way for all of us?
We have time for one more question.
Thank you. My name is Ivan. I'm Director of Education for Elsiboktuk First Nations Community. And your tripartite provincial collaboration, I was supposed to be there in Charlottetown Monday or Tuesday, but short notice. Just a comment on the 10-year plan, the education plan that's been announced, and the contents in it concerning First Nations teaching of history and languages and in Mi'kmaq and Maliseet. And the comment with one of the gentlemen up front there that said that when a 10-year engagement started, there was no mention of Mi'kmaq or Maliseet content, just more exposure to other cultures. So it was the push from the First Nations communities to have the department, the provincial government, to be coming around to our First Nation communities and engage the First Nation community in collaborating with them in what they want to see in the education plan. And it's great to have that written in the document. However, there still has to be a more of a public announcement at the government level, and I've been a firm believer to have the premier of the province to announce publicly that yes, indeed, New Brunswick is committed to teaching all of these First Nations histories and treaty education to all the kids in the province, and hopefully, like eventually, to have all the kids taught across the country, because reconciliation is the word of the day from now on. So my question is to de-educate or racism and prejudice out of the system, starting at our kids' levels, kindergarten levels. But a province like Manitoba, where they've been working with, and excuse my ignorance if I'm not all versed in it, but I understand that they've been working with treaty education and teaching in First Nations schools in the province for quite some time, but it's still considered to be the highest racism in the country. So why is that? And I'm a firm believer of educating young kids and educating racism and prejudice out of the system. But in Manitoba, it appears that that's not the case.
So if it's okay, I would like to just speak to something you said before I answer the question, and then I'll answer the question. I don't really know the answer to the question, but I'm going to. I just want to say that I appreciate you talking about how it was the Mi'kmaq and Maliseet people that pushed that to make sure that that was in the document and that that was in there in a significant way. Because if you look at the Indian Residential School Settlement Agreement, that also didn't happen because the federal government, you know, looked around and said, oh my gosh, we've been terrible. We need to do something different. We need to compensate survivors. And it didn't happen because of that. It happened because of a class action lawsuit that got settled out of court. right? It, because of the push of the survivors themselves and First Nation people. So I redirect that back to that question about law and how can that happen and how do we make this happen across the university. I think we can underestimate the power of the nation-to-nation relationship. I think it's getting harder and harder for people to, and organizations and governments and institutions to sort of deflect requests and requirements of First Nation people. And I think that as more and more discussion happens and things become more open, First Nation people are more and more willing to say, no, we're not going to just step back and stay out of the way. This is what's going to happen. So even though I know it's not, you know, it's not the responsibility of First Nation people to do everything that needs to be done, but just like it's important to have allies really step up and support Indigenous movements, I think it's really important and powerful to have, you know, if it's the nations in the territory that say, this needs to change now, and we are not actually backing up, we're here to help you, we're here to help support you in that, but this needs to change. So I want to thank you for bringing that up, because I think that that is the answer. There's both parts that need to come together. And I will see you in Charlottetown on the 17th and 18th of October. There's lots of notice. That's when we're meeting next. So the answer, I guess, I mean, I don't know that there is an answer, but I think it's a good question. And I think it goes back to how are we doing it then? Because Jamie Wilson was the treaty commissioner in Manitoba for a long time. I know some of the people that work in the Manitoba Treaty Commission in education. They're amazing. They do amazing work. They work with the Manitoba Teachers Society. They work with the ministry. There's been lots of education. But I think your question is really the question that we need to be asking ourselves. How is it that still, with all the education around treaties in that territory, in Saskatchewan, look what happened in Saskatchewan 2 weeks ago. Tragic. With that young man that was shot. And look at some of the comments that people thought it was okay to make publicly. Like, his biggest mistake was leaving three witnesses. Who says that? And that those are the two regions that have had the most extensive treaty education in the school systems. So I think we have to ask ourselves the question, what are we doing well, what are we missing? What still needs to happen? How are we doing this? And maybe it goes back to part of it, maybe is around, is that taught only as a subject? Is it only in the schools? You know, we get the people in the courses that want to learn. You talked about that in the law. People decide that they're going to. It's always that preaching to the choir thing, right? As long as there's a choice. I mean, think about all the things that are mandatory. We think mandatory is, you know, not a good idea. Think about all, pretty much everything's mandatory. You know, when it comes to school systems, you don't get to say, nah, I am always going to have a secretary anyway. I don't need to take English. Nobody would let that go. You have to take English classes if you're going to be a carpenter. You have to take English class if you're going to be a plumber. You always, or French, but you have to take one of those language classes. Nobody gets to say, I don't think so. I don't really like writing anyway. It's kind of boring. Somebody else can type faster than me, and, you know, everybody would say you're ridiculous. So who decides what's important? And who should learn it? So I would just actually invite people to think about that in their own context. How is it? And I was actually shocked. It's only 8 days, but I've been in Atlantic Canada, in the Maritimes for the last 8 days, and it's not the first time I've been here. But I'm hearing a lot of people sharing stories that are Indigenous over the last week as I'm traveling with people. And maybe it's because I'm getting to know people more, so, you know, as you get to know people as friends as well, it's not just that you're speaking and then gone. And people talking about the racism, the really shocking racism here. We talked about this last night at dinner. I said, isn't that interesting that I don't see that? Because at home, you see it. It is right out there, whether you're in Alberta where I live or in Manitoba, brutal racism. And I don't know what that is. I don't know if it's because a lot of First Nation people in the Plains are more visibly what people would think is Aboriginal, so people know that you're First Nation and there's no debate on that. I don't know what that is, but I was shocked to hear many of the stories the last few days about people, and mostly First Nation people, saying about the young people in the communities who don't want to identify. And one woman who's an amazing educator, who's First Nation, and being heartbroken because her daughter said to her when she got home from summer holidays, "I forgot how Native you are. Can you not come to school with me when I start at my new school this year?" Heartbreaking. Because she can slip by not looking Indigenous. But why? Why do we live in communities and schools and in a society where you still would just rather slip by as not being Indigenous because you're tired of doing the fight? That tells me we have a long ways to go.
I was thinking, in a previous life, in a different university, in a different place in this country, I was once a department chair. And a colleague of mine came to see me about creating a new syllabus for one of our intro courses on Canadian politics. And she said, "I would like to teach this course on the basis of Indigenous governance and decolonization." And I said, as department chair, "Let me think about that." And I went home that night trying to reimagine what this course would look like based on the syllabus she was proposing, having to recontextualize what I thought this course would look like. And when I came back to my office the next day, she had very helpfully put a poster on the bulletin board outside my office that said, "We are all treaty people." And she came to see me, and we talked about what the course would look like, and it was one of many sections of the course, and it was the most popular section of that course, and it's now continually being taught. We changed the name of the course, and it turned into something else, because Canadian politics really didn't sum up what that course was to be all about. And I've often thought since then, what was that process of reimagining? And I think we have a word now. Billowy de Haustawagon? Is that close? Okay. Billowy de Haustawagon. I want to think about that word. I'd like to know how to spell it. But I'd like to know how to use it properly. But it's a word that really got me thinking today, because Charlene, you've had us think in different directions, and many of us would have heard you this morning on CBC when you were speaking to the community about education and what education can do to change our mind's eye and our thinking. And I think that you hit the tone right this morning, because you talked about a system where educators and students come to believe that they know, but they don't know all of it, do they? And the system itself needs to change, doesn't it, in order for us to know more and to know better. And it got me thinking all morning, actually, about different histories and about different worldviews. And I would like to thank David and Imelda for being our educators, amongst our educators in this community, because every time they speak, I learn something, and I think a little bit differently. And Imelda, last week, some of us were present at an event where Imelda spoke about the objectifying language of English, yes? And how language in English objectifies the microphone, the stage, that, right. And I have a feeling that Billowy de Haustawagon is not an objectified word. And it's actually a word that's flowing off my tongue now that I've said it three times. And I like that. There's a musicality to the word as well, and there's a rhythm and a cadence to it. Yes, yeah, I like that. So language is important because communication is so important. And what you've done this afternoon has pulled our thinking in so many different directions, and I'd like to thank you for that. I think on behalf of everyone here, we would like to thank those amongst us who are looking at different ways for us to build this different conceptualization, to reimagine the way that we think. And I'll commit myself and my office to work with you on this, so I've said it. someone's videotaping this anyway, and it's being recorded. I'd also like to thank Anne Sherman and the work that she's doing with our faculties and our students, because this is key. It's a first step. And in the short time that I've been here at UNB, I've seen steps that are long strides to get to Beluga Haustawagon, a better reimagining, I think. And I think we're on the right path, and we're working together, and it's the right step. And most importantly, I'd like to thank you, Charlene, for coming this afternoon and sharing your thoughts, thoughts that were very difficult for you to share, I'm sure, and equally difficult for us to listen to and to think about. And I'm sure none of us will leave this room not thinking about this for the rest of the day, and if not longer. So language is important. Communication is important. Language is important. So you live in Alberta. You work in Manitoba in Treaty One territory, the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe and the Ojibwe. So let me say Miigwech. And because you are here, let me say Wolowon. Merci. Thank you so much, Charlene. On behalf of all of us, thank you.